So this year, the goal is to, we did a sickle cell run last year, we'll do one this year. We want to do a gala and a health fair. We only have three people in our office, so volunteering from the community would help us greatly. I mean, anything, any direct connection, relationship, resource. I mean, if you are in your church and you guys have a health fair, please invite us. We'll come out and do an education session and talk about sickle cell. If you know a child who may have a teacher who doesn't know much about sickle cell, we go into the school system. We educate on John C. Smith's campus, to the athletes, UNC Charlotte, Queens College. We've even gone down to Belmont Abbey to talk to the athletes. We'll go into 504 IEP meeting to talk about sickle cell. So it's just a matter of you all reaching out to us so we can provide that education and information to the community. Number one, I guess if you just talk about sickle cell, ask questions. You know, we are affected as in the community. A lot of times you'll see where we know what a pink ribbon is for, breast cancer. However, what does a sickle cell ribbon look like? So it's because it's not a lot of talk. We don't do much talking about sickle cell. So if you are at church and September is Sickle Cell Awareness Month, if you guys want to do something for sickle cell that month, bring us out. Let us talk to somebody. Or you could be a spokesperson in your church and just talk about sickle cell. The more people that we have talking about sickle cell, it increases that awareness. We are starting a task force team with patients to go out and talk about sickle cell. It's important. This is their community, so we want to train them up and send them out, because it's only three of us, so we definitely need support and help here in Charlotte. So many different parts to that statement. So number one, I would tell your friend to call me. I'll pass out my cards. Definitely tell her to call me so that we can just direct her. Usually we'll provide a list of PCP providers and hematologists in the system, but a lot of times people want us to be very specific. And who knows sickle cell, who's passionate about sickle cell, and we can direct her in that direction. A lot of times you'll find with adult patients who, you know, do have chronic and acute symptoms, they can't work. And they depend on disability, and that's about, what, $700-$800 a month, and they depend on Medicaid, so they don't have the resources to. Does she have children?
She has one son.
So just think, $700 a month with one, with a kid, with a child. I don't know how they do it, but a lot of times, and so that's where we come in, with the resources and the social issues, social aspect. As far as you are concerned, that's your responsibility to educate your kids. I mean, you can't tell them who not to fall in love with, but education is key. You know, they are carriers for trait, so that means that their hemoglobin is AS. They have one normal gene and one sickle gene, which that means they have the propensity to pass that off to their children. The hope is that they pass off a normal gene, but that's not, you know, guaranteed. So yes, if they do marry somebody with sickle cell trait, they do increase their risk of having a baby with sickle cell disease, which ultimately we don't want. A lot of times people don't know that all newborns born in the United States with sickle cell disease have to take a prophylactic antibiotic from 3 months old to 5 years old twice a day. And that's a big deal. I mean, think about, can you take a multivitamin every day? No, I don't. I can't. I forget. I mean, it just happens. But just think, they have to give this newborn baby penicillin twice a day when they're 5 years old. So yeah, I would definitely encourage education. It's going to come back around for your children when they want to play sports in middle school and high school. It's on the athletic forms, you know, the physical forms. Do they have trait? Does your mom have trait? Does your grandmother have traits? Does some? It's going to come back around, and so you're going to have to produce those papers for trait.
And I would say, in terms of conversation, talk to your child early and often. Early and often. You know, he's not too young to, you know, grasp whatever it is you're trying to tell him, to explain to him you have sickle cell trait and how genes are passed. Okay, how we genetically inherit our skin color, our hair, our eye color, our hemoglobin. So constantly, you know, every so often, just review with them and ask them questions. you know, to gauge where his level of understanding is.
Usually, in this day, they newborn screening results, you know, so like when they do the heel prick for the babies, they can tell whether or not that baby has trait or disease. We follow up with a confirmation 3 months later if they do have disease, or actually it might be less than that time, maybe a month later, if you know, an abnormal hemoglobin result came back. And so it's usually at birth. I have met recently, I would say last year or maybe 2 years ago, a lady didn't know she had sickle cell disease until she had become pregnant, which is not common usually. And it may be misdiagnosed. I had another, actually a couple people. One lady didn't realize she had sickle cell disease until she went blind in one eye, sickle cell retinopathy. She had been misdiagnosed all of her life. Her doctor had told her she had arthritis, and so it was just a misdiagnosis. So it does happen, but it shouldn't happen these days. I mean, once they have that heel prick and electrophoresis is done, we should know.
Oh, I mean, it's just that the complication I was having with my sickle cell was not being detected by the x-ray. So, you know, like I said, I was having that, you know, back and chest pain that was very unbearable, but they couldn't prove what I was saying, if you will. They saw no evidence of what I was saying.
Yes, I sat down and spoke with Ms. Weeks last week, I believe it is. And so C.W. Williams House, I'm not sure how many primary care providers, but what you'll see with the adults is they want to trust their hematologist. Now that's their primary concern, is pain, whatever their sickle cell, whatever's going on with sickle cell, that's what they want to focus on. Not if they have a cold, or not if they need a pap smear, or not if they... So they go straight to their sickle cell doctor. And we want to redirect them and educate them that they do need a primary care provider. And so we talk with Ms. Weeks. That's definitely going to be a referral for our patients, is to get our patients to some of the providers there. Ms. Shirley Miller is in the back. She's actually Dr. Iffy's program manager. And just we'll get, and I know Ms. Deborah talked about having Dr. Iffy to come over and educate the providers on sickle cell. A lot of times you'll find that providers are nervous or maybe even afraid of even treating someone with sickle cell disease. See it all the time. I think for some of the patients, when they hear a doctor say, "How long have you had sickle cell?" You know, it really just loses a lot of trust for that patient. I mean, because we did say that sickle cell is what? A genetic disorder. So we will follow a patient from birth to death, socially. So that's what we're going to do with CW Williams. We're working out the memorandum of agreement, and hopefully it's going to be a really great thing. We will find, you know, a lot of the kids are taken care of because parents know that they need a pediatrician and they need a hematologist with sickle cell. The adults have lost a lot of trust over the years with some of the physicians here, and so we need to build that trust back up. And with the education that Dr. Iffy will hopefully do with the providers and her team, come over to C.W. Williams and just educate and build that bridge between primary care providers and hematologists. That's what we want to do.
Currently, right now, the only thing for a cure is a stem cell transplant. You have to have a matched sibling that matches you perfectly before they will do it. The success rate is, when it works, and when it doesn't, because you can come out of it with graft versus host disease, which is even worse than having sickle cell. So there are several clinical trials right now where they are doing stem cell transplants. You can go to the National Institutes of Health, get it done free of charge. But you have to have a matched sibling. They are doing tests right now for non-related donors, and they can use a parent as a donor also.
Okay.